you're unsufficiently terrified, stay with us. There's more along those themes. We're going to stay with that analysis as to whether or not, and I think we have a fair conclusion as the answer, but whether or not traditional solutions are still effective against modern breaches. We're going to look at five core methodologies that you can use to reduce the risk to your organization of attacks on credentials and attacks to your data. Will you please welcome from StealthBits, Mark Wilson.
Okay, so StealthBits Technologies, who's heard of us? Hands up. Exactly. You don't work for any of our partners already. So Stealth by name, Stealth, but could you just turn the lights down a little bit as well, please? It's really blinding. So StealthBits by name, StealthBits by nature, maybe Stealth Marketing as well. We've been around for about 16, 17 years and we work very heavily in the data access governance arena. We've recently started working with Ron and his team this year, so you will be hearing about us a lot, but we're also large, long-time partners of IBM. So it's been nice to hear about Watson and QRadar because we have, in the past we've won recognition from IBM for our integration with QRadar. So just to kind of put us in the picture of what we do. So one of the challenges I thought when I saw the list of people preceding me today and how cool some of these sessions would be, especially like the last one, which was exactly what I'd expect. And also the fact that I've actually got a worse slot than Dave from Palo Alto. You know, Dave, if you're around, I'll raise your coffee break and give you a lunch. That's already half an hour late. So what could I do? Could I add something really cool, something cutting edge, something funky? No, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you back to the absolute basics. Okay, back to the old school, back to 1995 techniques, and simply just think about credentials and access to data. So it's not going to be five steps. There's going to be quite a few steps and things you want to discuss. So let's get moving on. Credentials and data, all you've heard about from every single person on this stage today is data, data, data. Quite rightly so. A couple of people have mentioned credentials. It's absolutely critical. You can't talk about data without credentials. Why? Well, these are your most valuable assets. Every organization, without your data, without your credentials, you really do not even have a business. So whether you are a window cleaner and your data is nothing more than the guys you're going to go and clean the windows for today, or if you work for a pharmaceutical and your data is the next big thing in medicine, without the data, you have simply no business. And credentials are the guardians for that data. When was the last time anybody walked into a server room, unplugged a SAN unit, walked out? Just doesn't happen anymore. What people are going for are the credentials. When they're trying to breach your environment, they go in, they want your credentials, and they will use those credentials to access the data, to remove that data from your environment. And this is something that, especially the last session we've just had, is we need a massive change of mindset to mitigate these kind of breaches. And it really is quite simple. Irrespective of how much you've spent on intrusion detection, your network layers, your mail gateways, your encryption, whatever it is, you have to think we will be compromised. And if you haven't been compromised yet, you're very, very lucky. The chances are there's something already in your environment now. Change this mindset and you're going to help yourselves to start mitigating the risk, because you'll never actually stop the risk. It's about mitigation and damage limitation. So as I said, back to basics. So we can't do a presentation without some statistics. Now, take these statistics slightly with a pinch of salt, because statistics are what they are, just numbers. So, unstructured data. In your organization, around 80% of your data will be unstructured. What is unstructured data? Unstructured data is, by definition, things that isn't in a set format. So, structured data is what you'd find in a database. It's what you'd find in applications. You know where a database is, everything comes in a nicely formatted table. And because it's structured, it's easy to understand, easy to find. Excuse me. Unstructured data consists of your general file systems. Windows file systems, your SANs, your NASes, EMCs, NetApp, whatever the vendor it is. Unstructured, they can be anywhere in your environment whatsoever. It could also be your SharePoint, on-premise, off-premise. It could be your cloud storage. It could be your email systems. Now, I have email administrator saying, but Mark, Exchange has a database. Yes, it does. but that information also flies around the network. You also have offline files. So when you take your laptop away, you have a copy of your mailbox. You have PST files. So this is unstructured data. And by definition, it's hard to manage, hard to keep track of. And then Active Directory, moving on to credentials. Around 95% of organizations use Active Directory as a primary source of authentication. And by that I mean, I'm presuming pretty much everybody in here has a username, you have a password. You have a computer that you have to use that username and password to log onto. Chances are that's going to be stored in Active Directory. In Active Directory, you have policies that configure all your machines, all your user accounts, even things like your password complexity rules. Now, it can also actually be used for structured data. So if you access a database or an application, the chances are you're going to be using Windows authentication. So surely you need to really be considering security for Active Directory as one of your top priorities. Now, you put all this together, and considering Active Directory is a primary source of authentication and ways of accessing your data, this is a scenario we get. Now, this isn't an actual statistic. This is just based on experience. From my experience, we've found around 70% of users in organizations have excessive access. Now, excessive access is where you have access to a file. Maybe you can only read the file, but you don't actually have a business requirement to even read that file. Or maybe you can modify, delete, and change that file, but all you need to do is read. This is excessive access. Now, if you was to ask me, Mark, how widespread is this problem, I would say it's nearly 100% of organizations I've ever been into in my career have this to at least some extent. I'm going to cover further on why this is a big problem. And then data breaches. This kind of goes into the GDPR and everything else you've heard as well. On average, it's a debatable figure. It takes around 201 days for a data breach to be discovered. To be honest, the chances are most data breaches aren't even discovered because they're not necessarily these huge, massive things like Yahoo. So, following on the kind of paranoid theme and the thinking, you know, we will be breached, you need to understand the basic mechanics of a breach to understand how to mitigate the risk. So the first thing we're gonna look at is, so it was mentioned the insider threat was mentioned earlier this morning, and he was saying, okay, the administrator maybe isn't the biggest threat. It's certainly a massive thing you do need to appreciate. So we're going to look at what your IT guys potentially have access to and exactly how powerful they can be. Now, I've modeled this on myself. So I used to be an administrator. I used to work for an ambulance service in the Northwest. And this is something you see in the public sector. You see a lot in the small to medium organizations where you have an IT guy who does everything. Maybe not so much in the larger enterprises, where you have very segregated teams. So what you'll have is you'll have an IT guy, maybe been there a long time, he's access to every single computer. He can do what he wants, he can remotely connect to the computer, shadow sessions. He manages Active Directory, so he has access to every single user account, all the administrative accounts, all the VIP accounts, all the groups that provide them access, and all the policies that govern how these are used. He has access to every single piece of data. Now, even though his account may not be permissioned on that data, he can still go into the data store, take ownership, and do things with that information. It's the same for SharePoint, the same for your cloud storage. And then email. The guy probably manages your Exchange environment as well. If he does, so not only can he access your mailboxes without you knowing, he could even send an email as you. So I could go in, open an email, put send as, and put it for my CEO, and send it to our competitor's CEO, and just think of, you know, the issues that could cause. And the mail flow. So obviously mail flies around. What an administrator could do is actually change where the mail is moving to and from. So every piece of email in your environment could be intercepted by this guy. And the question when it comes to compliance in auditing is who audits the auditor? Well, this IT guy is also that guy as well. So he can decide through policies what's been audited, how it's been audited, removing the audits. So this guy, in essence, could be God in your environment. Just something to be aware of. Now, I've mentioned the auditing on there, and think real time. So if you're using native auditing functionalities, which tends to involve writing to log files. So if you think about this, how long does it take for you to get the information to be told something has occurred? So if you're writing, if you're in a large organization with multiple Active Directories, multiple sites, loads of domain controllers where you're authenticating to, loads of file servers. You're waiting for these log files to be written to a file. You're waiting for some technology, maybe like QRadar, to come and gather this information, pull it to a central location, query it, and then trigger an alert. It could be 5-10 minutes. By that time, the person's left the building. So what you want to consider when it comes to watching these guys is maybe think real time. Something you really need to consider. So everything we've looked at from that guy, what we have is we have valid credentials, we have access to data, we have a motive, something you can't account for. So if it's a rogue administrator, it's somebody who's just disgruntled with their employer who wants to cause some damage. Or it could be somebody who's received a nice payoff from somebody. Now, when you're going for jobs in secure environments, maybe something that requires an SC or DV clearance, one of the things they vet when they're checking your background is your financial background, checking your close family's financial background to see how susceptible you are to bribery. And this is the reason why, because a godlike account with the motive is an extremely dangerous thing, and it will lead to data breach. Think of the NSA. Think of the incident that occurred last year. A former Navy operative working in NSA as a contractor, he had the credentials. Malware and ransomware, we can't talk about data breach without these two. Everybody's kind of mentioned them already. Now, what we haven't discussed is how it works. Now, I'm not going to go into the nth degree of every single variant of malware and ransomware that's available, and I don't apologize for this being extremely dumbed down, but it's important for you to understand the mechanics of how these work in your environment so you can, again, mitigate the risk. So the first step is, well, it gets into your environment. How's it get into your environment? Well, it could be a combination of email, torrents, external devices, social media. We guarantee the endpoint, the laptop, the desktop will be compromised. It will be on that machine. And on that machine, you will have somebody who's logged in using a credential. But also, the chances are you maybe have what's called a cached credential. So if you have a laptop, that's a work laptop, and you go home, you can still log on with your normal account, it's because you have a cached credential. Maybe you have a kiosk machine, a hot desk machine, where you have lots of people logging on, maybe a terminal server. You could have dozens or even hundreds of cached credentials. So what will happen is the malware can take one of those credentials and use that to propagate around the network. So what it will do is, and this is a diagram for something called a lateral movement attack. So from a single point of a compromised machine, one or more of those accounts will be used to try and authenticate across the whole network. Some will fail, some will be successful. And what happens is it gets to the machine and it again picks up that credential, uses that credential to propagate and move and move, and as it goes, drops its payload, like a virus. That's where the virus, I think, obviously comes from. This is just an example of a simple CryptoLocker-style ransomware attack. That's how it happens. The malware will hijack a credential, it will try and propagate around the environment, and it will continue to do so until you stop it, and it will drop its payload as it goes, and then you get held for ransom in this case. But that's a really high level of how things work. So what we have here is just to outline what's happened here is you have a compromised credential, you have valid access to data that credential has been given, but you've also got the human element. Unfortunately, humans, wherever humans are involved, there's going to be an issue. And the human element could be as simple as someone clicking on an email mistakenly at some point, and you've got a perfect storm for data breach. Now, Tout Le Monde, what's this got to do with anything? So I want to give you an example of where I've seen this in a real life example. So I was doing a proof of concept at a Swiss organization. Is it Swiss? Anyway, somewhere French speaking, about a year ago. And during the 30 days we were doing the proof of concept, they had a ransomware attack, not while we was on site. So very quickly we were able to say, okay, on average the file activity in this environment for a person was around 2,000 file accesses a day. We saw a massive spike for one account. It was 200,000 in one day. So we could say straight away, okay, this account was compromised. It was on this date. Very, very simple. We could see all the files that had been compromised, not a problem. But the interesting thing was, how was this allowed to occur? So this was allowed to occur because when we looked at the permissions and the excessive access across that environment, this user account, and this user was just a normal administrator, nothing funky. They had access to 300,000 folders in that environment when they only ever used 200 folders. Now, if they had permissioned their file estate correctly, yes, that person's credential will still have been compromised. Yes, there will have been a data compromise, but it would have only been effective to 200 folders, not 300,000 folders. So the moral of the story is you need to think about excessive access and locking down the excessive access. more statistics, because one slide obviously isn't enough. So, again, take these with a pinch of salt. These were taken from the end, towards the end of last year. Now, I don't necessarily think these are going to be the same. So around 50% of organizations have had at least one ransomware incident. It's probably higher, to be fair. These are just reported incidents. But interestingly, more than one, well, 1% have had more than 20 incidents. Now, why is this? Well, it could be that they're just unlucky and ransomware is indiscriminate. Okay, fair enough. It could be that they've never actually cleaned up the infected files and it's just reoccurred. It could be, and more likely it's going to be, is maybe they've paid the ransom. Now, if you pay that ransom, you get marked as a sucker. You know, you've paid the ransom, well, let's go back and attack them again, let's go back and attack them again. Why not? Because we know they pay. And this is a scary one. A lot of people think you can just recover from backup. 58% of ransomware incidents don't have a successful recovery from backup. Why? Because backup regimes aren't always all that successful. Backup regimes may have actually backed up the infected files. Maybe the ransomware variant actually attacked the backups before it attacked the live files. So you have nothing to recover. And this is the one I really like, is 61% originated from email. That's an email that's been opened, maybe with one of those really good looking, you've got a problem with your PayPal account emails. And it will have a malicious link, a malicious document with a macro or something in there. But 61%. Now, moving that forward, to put this into context, in comparison, only 3% originated from USB. Now, if you was to ask the layman in the street, what's one of the biggest risks? If you was to ask me 15 years ago, what was one of the biggest risks in my environment, I'd say USB pen drives, lock everything down. But only 3% are originating from USB. It's all coming from email. So, this is where I get a bit more interactive and ask for a show of hands. Now, I'm mentioning personal email. So, think of the scenario. Who in this room accesses a personal email from a corporate desktop, a corporate laptop while connected to network? Hands up. Okay. Who accesses a personal email from a work-issue mobile device? An iPhone, an Android? Okay, yeah. Who accesses email from a device that's got some sort of bring-your-own-device management software on there? Maybe not, because not everyone does BYOD. Who accesses their email from a personal device that they also use to access the corporate email as well? Okay, so think about it. Personal email. Personal email is your email. It's not managed by your IT guys. Okay, you could spend every penny you want on the perimeter defenses, on the security, on the mail gateways, everything you want. The minute somebody opens Hotmail, somebody opens Gmail, connected to your network, you've just completely circumvented every single one of those intrusion detection and perimeter defenses you have. Every single one. So my advice, and it's not very popular to the users, block it. It's a big, big problem. If you're getting 61% of virus attacks are coming from email, you need to think about this. Let's face it, you're in the business of maintaining business continuity, not allowing people to check their emails, see what they're doing at the weekend. So, still on the topic of email, corporate mailboxes, obviously another source, but these do have the security layers around them. 5-10 years ago, mailboxes, we all had limits, we were headquarters, we were all very small. All the managers used to hassle the IT guys, can you raise my limit to give me more space, because I'm running out of space. The IT guy would say, have you deleted your sent items, have you deleted or cleared out your deleted items? Fine, it wasn't a problem. Your mailbox was literally just a mailbox. However, now, storage is cheap. Your mailbox quarters are huge. Mine's 20 gigabytes. It's huge. So what you actually have there is another form of storage of data. Now, everybody in this room, I'm sure, gets everything in their mailbox from what you're doing at lunchtime through to financial information, HR information. It could be anything, okay? Again, show of hands. Who under their corporate mailbox inbox has a set of folders that they move things into and stores it there? Yeah, that's how we do it. Talking about credentials and this. Now, this is my personal iPhone. I have my work email on this. It's automatically logged into my email. All I have to do is swipe, fingerprint, I can access my email without even putting my username and password in. It's already configured. Okay, and I have access to every single item of data in my mailbox. So if this is stolen and someone has my PIN number or chops a finger off and does whatever they do with the touch fingerprint thing, they have access to everything. Think about what you're actually doing. Email is one of the biggest risks in your environment. And it's, you know, this isn't managed by the IT guys. So, think old school. Think about your housekeeping. Think what you keep in your mailbox and what you're doing with it. So, control and mitigate. Think of some things that we can do to actually stop bad things happening to your data and your credentials. This beggars belief. Proper security configurations. Surely everybody follows best practice and configures Active Directory files the best way. No, they don't. It's terrible. There's very few Active Directories that are clean and follow Microsoft best practices. There are very, very few file systems that have a nice, tight regime and resource-based groups. Very, very few. So follow best practice. Detect violations of security policy. So if you have the policies, enforce them. If people don't follow the policies, get your HR team involved. Make sure people follow the policies. And this is the big one, segregation of duty. Segregation of duty is basically where you're splitting up the roles, and this really applies to the IT teams. So think about your IT guy with an admin requirement, but he's also a normal user as well, because he does office documents and does his email. Segregation duty dictates that your IT guy should log onto his machine with his normal user account with no admin credentials, and then do everything remotely, or what you call log on as, or log on as. So you just run the facilities as an administrator. So if think about the ransomware scenario, if that guy's computer is compromised, it's only compromising his normal user account. In fact, let me go back to that one. I'll give you an example of something, again, another that live installation did with this. So I was installing one of our tools which does that real-time alerting, real-time auditing, but it also does authentication analytics, so we can look for every bit of authentication that comes into Active Directory. So I was installing this in the environment with one of the IT guys. We turned it on, and immediately we saw what looked like a horizontal movement or a lateral movement malware attack, because we were getting thousands and thousands of authentication attempts from a single point. Turned out it was the guy sat across from us. So he's like, oh, well, what do we do? Well, first of all, just pull his cable out. That's the first thing to do. So he went around, had a look. Two things. He was logged onto his machine with his admin account, domain administrator account, so he could authenticate to every single machine in the environment, and he was running a torrent client. So when we talk about enforce your security policies, because it's that IT guy who wasn't following his own security policies that they had a massive ransomware attack. Restrict authentication. What this means is, if you don't need to log onto somewhere, block it. Don't allow people to log onto there. This is where like privileged account management solutions come in. You know, you can block where people can log onto. Secure Active Directory, as we mentioned, Active Directory is the guardian of your data. You wouldn't leave your house keys hanging up outside your front window. So why would you do the same for the guardian of all your data? Secure Active Directory, make sure everything is stable and running well. And follow data access governance best practices. What is that? Well, it's quite simple, really. It's about governing who has access to what. You know, it's about giving people the right access to the right data in the most secure and efficient manner. And following something called Principle of Least Privilege, POLP, P-O-L-P. And what this means is, everybody in your environment has no access whatsoever. That's where you start. If you did access to a file to read it for 2 weeks, you're given access to that file to read it for 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, it's removed. If the person changes job, the old access is removed, the new access is given. Follow Principle of Least Privilege. Again, a no-brainer. Monitor file activity. Now, I'm not telling you to monitor every single file in your environment because, one, there'd be too much noise. You don't really care about 90% of the file activity in your environment. But find where your sensitive data is. Find out where the personally identifiable data is, the EU citizen data is for GDPR. Find out where your top secret information is if you're a pharmaceutical or your HR information is. Find out where it is. Monitor it in real time. Understand the normal activities and look for the things that are slightly different. Look for suspicious patterns. And by suspicious patterns, I don't mean the 3,000 files that have been compromised or the 200 logins. We're going to look for the small events, because these are the ones that could cause you the real serious problem. Now, I was not looking on that, okay. So what we're looking at here is going to give an example of what I mean by small event, and also doing something, understanding false positives when it comes to auditing as well. What we have here is an example. On the left-hand side could be number of authentications or logons, a day, and the days. So we have a week here. So in essence, this account, I'm going to go over by a couple of minutes, sorry. So what we're going to have is this account does nothing for 6 days. Then another Sunday, 100 authentications. Traditional auditing will tell you, oh my God, this is a big problem. Let's zoom out, 4 weeks. Well, actually, it's a pattern. This is normal activity. You zoom out, and do you know what? This may be a service account. If this could be authentications, this could be accessing files. This is actually normal. Zoom out even further. 8 weeks. It could be 2 years. You can see it does this thing. What you're looking for is that one small incident that you may not spot. You know, you access one file and one server you never accessed before. It's that one authentication you never spotted. Now, the problem with this is traditional auditing cannot do this, because to gather that kind of information and to analyze that kind of information is just not possible with normal techniques. And this is where we come to something that was mentioned in the previous session: user and entity behavior analytics. You've all heard of UBA. So many organizations, especially ISVs, software vendors like myself, we're talking about this. And what does it consist of and why? Again, really high level. This technology has big data. It allows you to store vast amounts of information, information that will allow you to look for patterns over the period of 12 months, 18 months, 2 years. It will use machine learning to look for and understand the basic principles of normal activity and look for the outliers. And by the outliers is that small event you may not normally notice. So when you apply these principles and we look back at what we looked at earlier on, we're not stopping things from occurring, we're minimizing the attack surface. So we're taking the administrator, giving him the access he needs, just manage the local computers, local users, local groups. You forget Exchange, you don't need it. Go back to the, look at the ransomware attack pad. Things will still get into your environment. Your machine will still be compromised. Your credentials will still be compromised. However, because maybe you're removing cached credentials, maybe you applied principle of least privilege, when that account is compromised, the damage it can do is massively restricted. So, change of mindset. We will be compromised because you will or you already have been. Control and mitigate the risk. You're never going to be able to stop it. The hackers are one step ahead. They always will be. And to tie into GDPR, from a data governance perspective, what we've discussed, all of these are the core principles of privacy by design. You have to implement these things to ensure that people can't access the wrong data in the wrong manner. And there we go.